Welcome back to the Melodic Caring Project. Today we head to Santa Barbara, California to connect with ALO frontman Zach Gill. Zach shares some of his most meaningful music experiences and talks about music as adventure. He also plays and dedicates a song to our rock stars and healthcare providers all around the country. Let's go! So we can come from the future. Go by the past. I bought my ticket for the 15th century. We started moving. Joining us from his very own personal music Valhalla in Santa Barbara, California, Zach Gill from ALO. Good to see you, man. How are you? Good.
I'm great. Great. All things considered, I'm great.
Good, good. So you are, it seems like, in musical paradise right now. So how is the downtime treating you? Are you able to try out some of those instruments that have been on the wall waiting for you?
Yeah, I mean, I'm like in full. I feel, you know, I know there's so much suffering going on in the world, but I'm enjoying my time in the studio. And it's afforded me the time to work on all sorts of harebrained ideas. And, you know, like, I have an album coming out soon that I made all in the lounge, and I pretty much used every instrument in here.
Really?
and it's an instrumental, I call it cocktail yoga. It's dreamy sounds. Every song's pretty long and full of musical textures. It's more like sonic landscapes than it is actual songs.
Yeah, so real atmospheric and...
Very atmospheric. Kind of spring was springing here in Santa Barbara as it was happening, so tons of birds on there, and that was... Yeah, I've just been recording.
So how have things been? You know, I mean, this sounds like already the start to the answer of the question I'm about to ask, but you know, what's something you have taken out of this experience of downtime and being home and really kind of being able to focus on writing that you would hope to take with you when things kind of get back to normal and you're back on tour, you know?
Well, you know, it makes you, there's different elements to it. You know, for me touring, I mean, that's, you know, generally how I make a living. So there's, you know, if there was ever something that was like the rat race, touring for me, and it's not a bad thing, but it's the thing where you're like, all right, get back out there and start doing that. And sometimes you do it because it's wonderful, but sometimes you do it. I mean, that's almost like the job part of the work, you know, where you're like, I'd like to just stay home and work on cocktail yoga, but we should go play these shows, and the show is wonderful, but you know, a lot of effort. Get back and forth across the country or to wherever you're headed. So trying to stay creative in the moment. That's what I'd like to, that seems to make me happy. So anything from that I can take moving forward, you know, get your house in order, stay creative in the moment. That's a good live all the time.
Yeah, it's interesting, you know, because we had a conversation yesterday where it was this idea that, hey, there's so much downtime, you must be super creative right now. But the reality is creativity also comes from a space of happiness of, you know, I mean, not all creativity, obviously, but anxiety and uncertainty and all of these emotions that are being inspired by this are not necessarily the greatest creative space to work out of, you know? So how's that been for you?
Well, that, you know, I mean, the anxiety really hit in those first couple weeks. And there was this weird, you know, my last gig was March 7th. And as, you know, we were going into the gig, you know, it was like Seattle's closing down. There was all this sort of like things happening. And there were a lot of people, you know, I mean, it was a big venue for us. It was the Warfield and in San Francisco, which was one of the bigger places we'd ever played headlining before. And you know, and there was all sorts of like, I don't know, you know, tickets had sold great, but there was all this like, you know, day of show, people being like, I'm not going, I'm not feeling great, this is getting weird. And even our, you know, it was a local show for us. We grew up in the Bay Area, and even our parents were like, I don't know if we're going to come. This is seeming, you know, and there was this kind of feel permeating the air. And it was a great night, and it felt like a little bit, in retrospect, it was a great last hurrah for a while, because it was an epic show. Wavy Gravy was there, and Leftover
no
Salmon.
Way.
It was an epic alley for us, you know. It felt, that was a good one to go out for a while.
Yeah, absolutely. Like you say, like the that is a final hurrah if ever there was one.
I mean, yeah. But then, you know, the anxiety kicked in, and then it was like we were headed to Seattle the weekend after, and that was canceled. And then quickly, you know, things just started canceling. I play in Jack Johnson's band as well, and we had a whole summer festival thing canceled, and now things feel a little better this week. But
it's interesting, you know, because with being an artist and with having this gift and this thing to share that can create joy and can create togetherness and connection and all of these things that we desperately need right now, how does that feel like a blessing, or does that feel like a burden, like an expectation, you know, that now I have to create something to bring us together, you know?
Yeah, no, I mean, I've been running that kind of MO for a while that, you know, and I'm still, I try to be true to whatever my personal, you know, muse is telling me, like, I should be true to. But I, you know, you try to, especially these days, everybody's so critical of everything, and you certainly don't want to strike the wrong tone, but then you also realize that not every song is meant for everyone.
Right.
And so I kind of hope that, you know, and I've had this happen to me where you're just like, music can be so transcendent, and it can happen in a shopping mall, you know, when it's in the background, it can happen in a crowd of people. So you just kind of hope that, you know, my faith in the process is that it finds the people that it needs to find, and you put it out there a little bit like a paper ship or a message in a bottle, and the right person. So I tend to, sometimes I'll get, you know, especially, I'll just be like, a song that I like wrote for my dad for Father's Day. And you're like, well, this is really specific to me and my dad, but, you know, somebody else will find it and the energy's there and it'll resonate. And yeah, so I don't see it as a burden. I see it as a noteworthy challenge, a quest. But but I flail at it all the time. You know?
Well,
not saying I've mastered it at all. But I try my best. You know?
Well, a quest from Valhalla seems like the perfect way to put it, for sure. So well
yeah.
done. What
yeah.
I'm curious,
yeah.
with that, what do you have a specific memory of a time that music was really powerful or changed or created, you know, a connection that you wouldn't have otherwise seen? What's your strongest music memory?
I mean, there's so many. I mean, I remember the first time I really felt the thing was like, maybe I was like in fourth grade and I went to see Huey Lewis in the News with my mom, and it was, you know, it was like the peak of their popularity. They sold out, you know, five nights in a row at the Oakland Coliseum. Back to the Future had just come out. Power of Love was the number one song in the world, and they were from the Bay Area, and they were playing Oakland Coliseum, and the Tower of Power horn section was with them. And I mean, you know, I Want a New Drug was like 30 minutes long, the song, you know, I mean, they were out there firing on all cylinders, and we were at the very, very top of the stadium, and you know, I just reworded every song, and these girls in front of me, how much older they were, but I was with my mom, you know, and they were like maybe teenage, saw how stoked I was, and they sort of like grabbed my hands and danced with me, and we all along, these strangers, and I was, that point, you know, it's fourth grade, I was like afraid of girls for sure, like older ones specifically. and I just remember being like, that was something. And then after that, I kind of had the bug. I thought like, well, that, if you could do something in life, that would be. And then I remember, you know, maybe years later at the same stadium seeing Billy Joel, and he ended the set, you know, and it was awesome. And he was, you know, in peak form too, you know, and he ended the set with Piano Man and everybody in total darkness with just him and the piano. And then the crowd just took over the vocals, you know, and this whole stadium of people singing, Sing Us a Song, you're the Piano Man. I just thought that is something. But then recently, I mean, I'm digressing, but then recently, this is so random, but, you know, I've got a younger daughter who's now in fourth grade. And then I've got an older daughter who's in college. And a couple of years ago, that Call Me Maybe song, you know that song?
Yeah, oh, I do.
Call Me Maybe was out. Yeah, everybody knows that song.
I've got a 12 and a 10-year-old myself, so yeah.
Yeah, so that song was out and about. And then it maybe had even disappeared, but it came back in that movie Sing. You know, it was like in the, I don't know if you saw Sing, but it was in there. And somehow that my daughter was having some like confidence problems, or I don't even remember, but that song came on and there was something about the way she's like, call me maybe, like, and I just thought like, well, that's the bravest thing I've ever heard. You know, to put yourself out there into this world, and that song's so positive sounding, you know, and it's like, hey, I just met you, this is crazy, you know, call me maybe. You know, just like, I don't know what's going, you know, there's something about the energy just made me feel like, you know, when you hear like the Beatles, I Want to Hold Your Hand, like so innocent and sweet, yeah, but also true, and that like no one knows what's going to happen. This world is very mysterious, and you get older and you think you know, and you get your heart hardens and you're trying to figure stuff out and you're trying to protect yourself and your kids, and then, you know, there's just this, hey, call me, it could be fun, you know, and then you just think, oh, that's about as brave as anything anyone's ever done, you know, in this modern era where it's so scary to, you know, it's like there's information overload and the future seems, can seem so dystopian at times, you know, and I just found that song super inspiring. And I mean, I guess the point is, it literally, I start crying. I mean, part of it's like my teenage daughter's like turning 18 or whatever, but I just start crying as the song plays. And I'm just like, this is so, and I don't know what's going on, if it's me and where I'm at in my life or what, this song is just making me feel something I didn't think I could feel. So,
man, I love that though, you know, because talk about a song that, depending on what your perspective is, could be just a, you know, a very almost hollow pop song.
Yeah, annoying.
That's the beauty, right? Is that it has a life for the person that's listening or viewing, and it depends on their perception. So every song has as many lives as it has listeners to that song. That's really cool.
That's a beautiful way to say it, as many lives as there are listeners, you know? Yeah, that's it, you know? And the pieces of the music are all made from these kind of biologically profound, it's like we hear music and you're like, what, you know, it's emotional for us, it's like tied to our genetics, you know, from, it's been with us as we've evolved, and it's like, I mean, you watch it without music and you're like, I don't even get it, but with the music you're like, oh, now I'm scared, now I'm happy, now I'm, you know, excited, and it's like the music is tied to our feelings. So,
well, man, so I love that music is, it is that, right? It's so profound to you, and you can create it, but you can also experience it on that level. What is, could you, in one word, wrap up what music means to you?
Venture. You know, it's still an adventure. Not a lot like it's an adventure. You know, it's exciting. It's dramatic. It's sometimes scary, sometimes tragic, sometimes joyful, but it's an adventure, a serious adventure that I'm lucky to be on.
I love it. So, speaking of adventure, what song do you have that you want to bring our rock stars and healthcare providers? What adventure do you want to bring them on?
Well, it's a simple little song. It's an ukulele number. I call it All Right Soon, and I wrote it years ago, but it feels like, you know, he was having a tough, and we were looking for, you know, how to stay. So the song kind of came out of that. I think it's, you know, I'm always looking for ways to stay, you know, keep myself from falling into the deep pit of existential drama. So, I, you know, this song speaks to that, I think.
I like it. Any specific kids or hospitals you want to dedicate it to?
Yeah, I do. I've got a list of some rock stars right here, real rock stars. I got Jonathan in Washington, and I've got Kira in Vermont, and I've got Rikson in Arizona, Health First Brevard Hospital System in Florida, the Bradford Regional Medical Center in Pennsylvania, Beth Israel Lahey Community Hospitals in Massachusetts, and Phoebe Putney Memorial in Georgia. All right, here we go. I'm gonna teach you the chorus. Feel free to sing along. It's gonna be all right soon. That's your part. Gonna be all right soon. And I
know that's an oversimplification of an endlessly complex situation. Still, it's true. It'll be all right soon. And I know that soon is a relative term. Could be later today or after your heart's been burned, turned into mush. Still, you gotta trust it's gonna be all right soon. Sing it with me. It's gonna be all right. Churches and in all the songs, the story that's still getting passed on has to do with this little theme of dreaming anew, of winter to spring, when the ship hits the can and the road gets dark, and hope is a tiny fragile spark you hang in there. Yes, I know that's an oversimplification of an endlessly complex situation, but I don't care. I like the sound. It's gonna be all right now.
Yes, it is gonna be all right. I completely agree, Zach. Thank you so much, man. Any final thoughts you want to leave with folks before we close down?
Hang in there. We'll ride this together.
Thank you all so much for joining us. If you or someone you know is battling illness and needs support, you are not alone. Sign up today at melodiccaring.org. And a huge thank you to all our first responders and healthcare providers working so hard during this COVID-19 crisis. We appreciate you. I'm Levi Ware. This is the Melodic Caring Project.